Welcome to ACCA IAS Academy, an online initiative, a program to guide the students for upcoming competitive examinations, especially in relevance with a preliminary examination, where we wanted to provide a wonderful impetus to our students to sail through in their attempts. In last class, we are discussing about the previous year's questions in relevance with medieval Indian history, that to culture, music and dance. Continuation, with reference to cultural history of India, consider the following statements. Most of the Tyagaraja Kritis are devotional songs in praise of Lord Krishna. Who was Tyagaraja? A gem of Carnatic music. Okay, Kritis are devotional songs in praise of Lord Krishna. See here, which is a real content means the praise of Lord Krishna, correct? And personality Tyagaraja, correct? Is it praise of Lord Krishna, the Tyagaraja Kirtanas? No, in praise of Lord Rama. Okay, it was a great devotee, tigrammer in praise of Lord Rama. Thereby, statement number one. If you go through statement number one, here, A, we can come across statement number one, and then C, we can come across statement number one. Then, what must be the probable choices? Either it may be B or it may be D. Right? Then, we will go through next statement. Look at the statement. Tyagaraja created several new ragas. Definitely, no doubt in that. Tyagaraja created new ragas. The two, there is a famous song of Tyagaraja, Enduro Mahanubhavulu. Enduro Mahanubhavulu. And remember, not only Enduro Mahanubhavulu, Tyagaraja was responsible for Nadopasana. Whenever you will go through the concept of Nadopasana, you must always try to remember Tyagaraja. Always try to understand the key concept Nadopasana in relevance with Tyagaraja. Then, statement number 2 is correct. Where we can come across statement 2, B and D. Next, we will go for the third statement. Annamayacharya and Tyagaraja are contemporaries. Yeah, if you go through the cultural history of India, where we can come across this statement. Correct, I remember. Who was Annamacharya? Talapaka Annamacharya, where great musician, he composed several songs, where those songs were popularly called as Kirtanas. Those songs were popularly called as Kirtanas. Talapaka Annamayacharya. He was not a contemporary of Tyagaraja. Just you try to jot down. Talapaka Annamacharya, a contemporary of Purandara Dasa. Tyagaraja, he was a contemporary of Purandara Dasa. Try to understand. He was a contemporary of Purandara Dasa. Talapaka Annamayacharya. Almost 32,000 kirtanas constituted. Even today, Annamayacharya kirtanas has got so much of relevance. In praise of whom? Lord Venkateshwar. Okay, Tetramal. Thereby, the third statement is not correct statement. Tetramal, try to apply your logic. Whenever third statement is not correct statement, means, what about answer? 2 and 4 are correct. Is it clear? 2 and 4 are correct. Then Annamayacharya Kirtanas are devotional songs in praise of Lord Venkateshwara. Definitely correct. Try to remember. Thereby, here, try to remember the keywords. There is the matter. Next, we will move on to one more important question. Community of people called Manganiyars is well known for their Manganiyars. Correct? Manganiyars. Where this Manganiyars, also known as what? Manganiyars also known as? They basically belong to the state of Rajasthan. Okay, basically belong to the state of Rajasthan. Manganiyars, they were also known as Mirasi. Manganiyars are also known as Mirasi. Right, remember, Manganiyars, they were also known as Mirasi. Traditional folk singers of Rajasthan. or Manganiyas. Manganiyas, they were traditional folk singers of Rajasthan, where they used to perform their music at the time of marriage functions. I remember where they used to perform music at the time of marriages. I remember our ritual occasions. Manganiyas, thereby the Manganiyas were considered as the folk singers of Jaisalmer and Barmer region of Rajasthan. Okay, they were folk singers of Jaisalmer and Barmer region of Rajasthan. Clear? Then here look at choices. Martial arts in Northeast India. Can you give an example for martial art of Northeast India? Because Northeast India, it has got its own culture, a unique culture when compared to the remaining parts of India, correct? Because North India, it always constitutes extended part of India or extended arm of India, correct? I remember where the North Indian states has got unique kind of cultures when compared to other parts of India, because India is basically a diversified country with a diversified culture, correct? I remember diversified communities. The best example I can give at this juncture, Tangta, correct? Yeah, Tangta, Manipur, where Tang means no. Oh, is it the Thai? No way. Tang means sword. Ta means spear. Correct? It must be correct only, no? Tangta is an important martial art. I remember. Important martial art mainly practiced by Miti tribe of Manipur. Miti tribe of Manipur. I remember. Exclusively practiced by Miti tribe of Manipur. Don't forget. Is it clear? Then musical tradition in Northwest India. Musical tradition. Yeah, right, remember. Musical tradition in Northwest India. Definitely, it must signify Manganiyas. Okay? Then the correct answer must be the musical tradition in Northwest India. Then classical vocal music in South India. Classical vocal music in South India, Carnatic music. Correct, right, remember. It's a vocal music. Correct, right, remember. Whereas Hindustani music, court based music. Hindustani music basically court based. Whereas Carnatic music is vocal based music. Isn't it? Then this is very, very important. Pitradura. They used to ask in your art and architecture or art and culture. What about Pitradura? What does it mean by Pitradura? We have already discussed in classes while dealing with Mughal history. Mughal art and architecture. What about Pitradura? Pitradura means on expensive art form of Mughals. An expensive art form of Mughals. Always try to remember. An expensive art form of Mughals. It basically constitutes the interior design of form practiced during the rule of Mughals, where it is also an interior design. It constitutes interior design of the Mughal monuments. The best example I can give you at this juncture, Itmad-ud-Dawla tomb of Noor Jahan. Okay, constructed in the memory of her father, Itmad-ud-Dawla. Okay, for the first time they used an art form called as Pitradura. And they will ask one more statement here. The Pitradura can be practiced only in white marble. Mm. And remember, the Pitradura art form, it was exclusively pertaining to the white marble. In red stone, it is not possible to constitute Pitradura. See, these points are important. Pitradura, where we can engrave only in white marble, please try to remember. Thereby, there are two important examples. One was Itmad-ud-Dawla tomb, and then second important one, Taj Mahal. Clear? Try to remember. These are the two important Mughal monuments where they practiced Chitradura. Here, then what about answer? Musical tradition in Northwest India. Next, we will move on to one more important question. The Sufi saint who maintained that devotional music was one way of coming close to God was. See here, try to understand properly. Coming close to what was the meaning of coming close to God? This is what you must understand. See, getting through in prelims, I already mentioned cakewalk. If you are acquainted with the precise concepts, key concepts, so easy, your name will linger in final selection list. You are entitled to write, means no doubt in that. Coming close to God, mystic. Okay, mystic. Is it not Sufi movement is a mystic movement? When any student who has got the basic understanding where Sufi movement must be considered as mystic movement, Bhakti movement must be considered as mystic movement. Coming close to God or complete surrender to the God. Correct? I remember mysticism. Thereby, when you go through the mystic concept, means the Sufi saint who maintained the devotional music was one way. See here, one more concept is there. Devotional music. The devotional music means what we will call samas. There are two concepts now, mystic and samas. Try to understand this. Then, Mainudin Chisti, the first Sufi saint of India. Correct? Try to remember, where he introduced the theme of Sufism. Okay, Chisti Sufism in India. Then here, whatever the statement they made with regard to which Sufi saint means, try to jot down. Baba Farid was also known as what? Farid Uddin Ganj E. Shakar. Farid Uddin Ganji Shakar. Are you getting my point? Farid Uddin Ganji Shakar. He was popularly called as Baba Farid. Which Sufi saint? He was popularly called as Baba Farid, means Fariduddin Ganji Shakar. But please try to remember, the place where he propagated the nuances of Sufism, Punjab. Not only in Punjab, even some parts of Haryana. Okay, try to remember, Punjab and Haryana, where he propagated the nuances of Sufism. Please try to remember, in two important states, Punjab and Haryana. Are you getting my point? Punjab and Haryana. And one more important point is there. The teachings, pragmatic teachings of Baba Parit included in Adi Granth. This is an important point. The pragmatic preachings. Are you getting my words? Pragmatic preachings of Baba Parit included in Adi Granth. Compiled by whom? Guru Arjun Dev. Okay? Guru Arjun Dev. Then Sayyid Muhammad Gesudaraj. The Sufi saint, he was responsible for propagation of Sufism in South India. Gesudaraj. The Sufi saint, he was responsible for popularization of Sufism in South India. Because when Muhammad bin Tughlaq transferred the capital from Delhi to Devagiri, where this Devagiri emerged as a capital of intellectuals. When it emerged as a capital of intellectuals, where the Sufis, they have made the inroads, try to remember, towards South India in order to propagate Sufism. Even today we can come across a Sufi saint tomb or Wali tomb. Wali means saint. Okay. Which saint tomb we can come across at Gulbarga? Kaja Bande Nawaz Darga. Correct, I remember, where it's a place of veneration both by Hindus as well as Muslims. Okay, Shah Alam Bukhari. You know, was Shalom Bukhari a renowned name? Religious teacher. He was also a religious teacher. He was not Sufi. He was not Sufi saint. He was a religious teacher. Clear? That's all. There is the matter. Then answer must be B. Next. With the reference to the religious history of medieval India, the Sufi mystics were known to pursue which of the following practices? I think we have already discussed this. Correct? Consider the following statements. Kitab-e-Nawras, a collection of songs in praise of Hindu deities and Muslim saints, was written by Ibrahim Adil Shah II. We have already discussed Kitab-e-Nawras. It mainly deals with nine rasas. Right, remember, nine. Kitab-e-Nawras. Now means nine. Ibrahim Adil Shah. Here he was popularly called as what? Jagadguru. Thereby, statement number one is correct. Here we can come across statement number one, A, and here we can easily eliminate. Here we can easily eliminate. Which one? Picture. E we can eliminate, and D we can also eliminate. Correct, I remember, it's so easy. B and D we can easily eliminate. Then what about the probable choices here? The probable choices must be either A, no, how come both, please try to remember, Amir Khusro was the originator in India of the early form of the musical style known as Qawwali. Correct, right? Remember, who was Amir Khusro? We have already studied with regard to Amir Khusro, popularly called as Indian Parrot. Correct, right? Remember, Artoti Ind, Amir Khusro, where he was popularly called as father of Qawwalis. Okay, whenever he was considered a father of Qawwali means the statement 2 must also be correct, thereby the answer must be C. Okay, both 1 and 2 are correct, isn't it? Both 1 and 2 are correct. That's very, very important. Then next we will move on to with reference to Drupad, one of the major tradition of India that has been kept alive for centuries, which of the following statements are correct? See here, Drupad, I already mentioned there are four important forms of Hindustani classical music. Which was the classical form of Hindustani music? Drupad. The oldest form of Hindustani music, that is Drupad. Followed by Khayal, Tumri and Tappa. Always try to remember these four. Okay, Drupad, Tumri, Tappa and Khayal. These are four important forms of Hindustani music. Who was called as father of Hindustani music? Who was called as father of Hindustani music? Suppose if they formulate that kind of statement in your examinations. Who was popularly called as father of Hindustani music? The father of Hindustani music, always try to remember, Tansen. Niyan Tansen, he was considered as father of Hindustani music. Is it clear? But here they will ask, among four, which form of Hindustani music considered as most popular form? Most popular form. This is where the crux lies. The students, they must understand the gist of it. Right, remember, students, they must understand. Khayal. Now the Khayal, it was considered as most popular form of Hindustani music. Always try to remember. Khayal, it was considered as the most popular form of Hindustani music. Hindustani music. I can give one important name, a great exponent of this, the Khayal, Girija Devi. Girija Devi, mother of Khayal. Girija Devi. She is no more. Try to remember, Girija Devi, exponent of Khayal. I am even Tumuri also. And Kishori Amonkar. And what about Kishori Amonkar? Yeah, Kishori Amonkar also. Kishori Amonkar. Amonkar. And in your competitive examinations, whenever you will go through Hindustani music, they will always focus on one more important concept, gharanas. This is very, very important, gharanas. Try to emphasize on musical gharana. Gharana means a unique kind of musical tradition developed by group of musicians. Try to remember, the gharana means a musical tradition developed by group of musicians. And remember, thereby gharana, we can come across different kinds of gharanas. For example, Gangubai Angal belongs to which gharana? Kirana gharana. For example, Tansen belongs to which gharana? Senia gharana. There are many gharanas are there in Hindustani musical tradition. Try to understand this. This is very, very important. Only in Hindustani music, especially, we can come across gharanas. Gharanas. Are you getting my point? And the oldest form of Hindustani music, Drupad. Don't forget. The oldest form of Hindustani music must be considered Drupad. But today, who played a revival role in Drupad means, please try to remember, or Drupad the Raga means Gundecha Brothers. I already mentioned Gundecha Brothers. Don't forget this. Gundecha Brothers. But the Drupad concept, it was first popularized by the Tansen in an important school, what we will call Gwalior School of Music. Right, remember, Gwalior, there only Raja Vikramajit, where he provided a title to Ramtanu Pandya's Tansen. Okay, Raja Vikramajit. Right, remember, where he provided a title called as Tansen. Earlier, what was the original name of Tansen? Ramtanu Pandya. We have already discussed. Thereby, try to go through it. Then, Drupad originated and developed in Rajput kingdoms during Mughal period. No, try to remember, correct, try to understand this. But whenever you will go through Drupad, you must always remember Gwalior School of Music. Yeah, Gwalior School of Music. Please try to remember, Gwalior School of Music. There is also an important musical text known as Mankautul. This is important. A musical text associated with Gwalior School of Music, Mankautul. Where this Mankautul, it belong to Raja Mansingh Tomar. Always try to remember. Raja Mansingh Tomar. He was ardent advocate of Gwalior School of Music. Ardent advocate. He was an ardent advocate of Gwalior School of Music. Where the several musicians who belong to Gwalior School. Even I want to introduce one more important name. Swami Haridas. Okay. Swami Haridas. Is it clear? Then, is it a correct statement? If you look at this first statement, it is not at all correct statement, or it is not having any relevance. Thereby, one, here we can come across the one, and then statement number one. Here also we can come across statement number one. Then what about the statement number two here? Drupad is primarily devotional and spiritual music, definitely. Drupad is primarily spiritual and devotional music, no doubt in that. Then statement number two is perfect, no doubt in that. And Drupad all of uses Sanskrit syllabus from mantras. That all of is known as what we will call it as in Hindustani music, we will call it as bandish. What you will call in Hindustani music, we will call it as bandish. Try to understand this. Thereby, we can also come across the Sanskrit syllabus from mantras. Right, remember, thereby 2 and 3 must be correct. Then answer must be B. 2 and 3 are correct, no doubt in that. Is it clear? Then next we will move on to dance forms. In India, it has got diversified cultures, means where we can come across the different dance forms. There are two kinds of dance forms, classical dance forms and folk dance forms. Correct, I remember. The UPSC people, sometimes they will ask rare concepts in your examinations. The concept which is so popular, they will never formulate a question based on that popular concept. Whenever the rare concepts are there, no, rarity is there, no, they will always pick the rare concepts rather than popular concepts. Suppose, if any dance form, it is in declining stage or it is at the verge of extinction, at the time where the concerned authorities, they must formulate the policies in order to revive, in order to rejuvenate that art form. Correct, I remember. At that time, the UPSC, it will always formulate questions on such concepts. Are you getting my point? Yeah. Try to understand the pulse. Try to touch the pulse of UPSC. Try to understand. Then, what about which one of the following dances involves solo performance? Solo performance. See, here, I have got doubt in my mind where the students, they can opt for Bharatanatyam. Correct? As an answer. Bharatanatyam is also a solo performance. Where for the first time, it owes its origin, which place? Bharatanatyam, which place where it owes its origin. For the first time, the nuances of a classical dance in South India emerged. Which place? The Bharatanatyam owes its origin to Tanjore. Always try to remember. Owes its origin to Tanjore. Why Tanjore means? There, at that time we can come across an important system known as Devadasi system. Where this Devadasi system, it developed as a social institution. Correct? Try to remember. Where the Devadasis mainly attached to the temple complexes, Devadasis mainly served as servants of God as well as the dancers in order to provide recreation to the rulers. Correct? I remember. Thereby, Bharatanatyam emerged as a classical dance at Tanjore. Even today, the Tanjore is considered as a cultural cradle of South India. Tanjore even today considers what? A cultural cradle of South India. Please write them. Cultural cradle or the capital, cultural capital of South India, Bharatanatyam. But whenever you will go through classical dances, know what are all the areas where you must emphasize means origin. Try to understand. This is very, very important. And then the characteristic features. Characteristic features. Whenever you will go through the characteristic features, try to emphasize on the keywords. That's all. Try to emphasize on keywords. If you know how to ascertain keywords means, thereby you can opt for right choice. Always try to understand this. One is origin, where it was originated, and then characteristic features. Okay, characteristic features. And then mode of performance. Mode of performance. The mode of performance is important. Either they used to perform solo or they used to perform in groups. Try to understand this mode of performance. And then next important one, the exponents associated with particular dance. Exponents. Are you getting my point? These are the four core areas. These are the four core areas. And suppose if any dance recently in news, that's all. Recently in news, there ends the matter. There ends the matter. Clear now? See, these are all the core areas. Then, if you go through the question involves solo performance, means Bharatanatyam, we can come across. Can you name two important exponents of Bharatanatyam? Two important exponents of Bharatanatyam. Okay, Bharatanatyam is also known as what? Bharatanatyam is also known as Sadir. It was popularly called as Sadir dance. They will ask, which one of the following classical dance considered as a Sadir dance? Then what about your answer here? This is where the crux lies here. Sadir dance. The Sadir dance means Bharatanatyam. Why Sadir dance means? Please try to remember the dance performed by Devadasis. When the dance performed by Devadasis, that's why the Bharatanatyam was popularly called as Sadir. Are you getting my point? Sadir dance. That's why it was also known as दासियत्तम 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 भरतनाट्यम इज ऑल्सो नोन एज दासियत्तम राधा रेड्डी सोनाल मान सिंग करेक्ट या मेनी मेनी वेर आई कैन नेम with with the spontaneity I can name. Is it clear? Bharatanatyam, for example, Tillana. What about Tillana? Tillana, it is a classical element basically performed attributed to Bharatanatyam. Try to remember Jatiswaram. Try to understand the important elements associated with particular classical dance. That's why important characters and classical elements. Try to add one more word here. The important characteristic features and the classical elements involved in that particular classical dance. Here now. And then Kuchipudi. Kuchipudi. It's a renowned dance form. Classical dance form. Originated from a village called Kuchelapuram of Andhra Pradesh. The performance of Kuchipudi known as what? Those who perform Kuchipudi known as what? The performers. Earlier, where the Kuchipudi, a classical dance, it was particularly performed by men. Okay, earlier it was a male dominated dance. And what is the characteristic feature of Kuchipudi? The characteristic feature of Kuchipudi is a combination of classical elements plus folk elements. This is very, very important. Kuchipudi is a combination of classical element and folk elements. It's a combination of classical and folk elements. Always try to remember, the performers of Kuchipudi was popularly called as Bhagavats. Always try to remember, Bhagavats. Bhagavats, where they used to move from place to place in order to perform Kuchipudi, they were popularly called as Bhagavats. Are you getting my point? Bhagavats. Then Mohini Attam, is it not? Mohini Attam is also a solo performance. See, the Mohini Attam, is it not? It is also solo performance. Mohini Attam, Mohini belongs to which state? Mohini. Kerala, Mohini Attam, correct? Try to remember, Kerala. Mohini Attam. Mohini Attam is also a solo performance here. Try to remember, that's why. That's why. Here, in my view, answer must be A and C here, not A. I don't know why they have formulated this kind of question. See? Yeah, yeah. It must be A and C, not A only. Not A only. Try to understand this. They are also human beings, no, yeah. They can also commit errors, no? Yeah, yeah. What is there in that? Huh? Then Odissi. Yeah, the name itself signifies its state, Odissi. See, when compared to other classical dances, a unique feature involved under the ambit of Odissi dance. Which was that unique feature of Odissi dance? Unique feature. Anybody? Here, the unique element Gotipuas. This is important. Gotipuas. Gotipuas means the boys, they used to dress in female attire to perform the dance in temples. I remember, especially called as Gotipuas. The boys, and then where this Odissi, the performers of Odissi, also known as Maharis. Put it in inverted commas. Maharis. See, these are important concepts from your examination perspective. Maharis. Clear? Mahari means again what? Devadasis. Devadasis. The answer must be, in my view, answer not only A, even C also. Perfect here, no doubt in that here. It must be A and C here. Here, origin, the characteristic features and classical elements, mode of performance, and then exponents, and if any classical dance recently used. There is the matter. Then answer must be Bharatanatyam. Next we will move on to one more important question. How do you distinguish between Kuchipudi and Bharatanatyam? Remember, both classical dances originated from South India. Correct? Both. Try to understand. That's why that comparison or the comparative analysis. Kuchipudi and Bharatanatyam. Both. Come on. Look at these statements. The dancers occasionally speaking dialogues is found in Kuchipudi dance but not in Bharatanatyam. Dancers occasionally speaking dialogues is found in Kuchipudi dance but not in Bharatanatyam. Is it a right statement or wrong statement? Right statement. Okay. See, that's why whenever you will go through this Kuchipudi, no? In Kuchipudi, we can come across an important concept called as Bhamakalpam. Bhamakalpam. Whenever we will go through, that's why I told the elements. If you go through Bhamakalpam, the Bhamakalpam happens through the conversation. Remember, through the conversation. Whenever it happens through the conversation means, definitely speaking dialogues must be there. Remember, Bhamakalpam. This is an important characteristic feature. Then only where you can opt for right choice, a right statement. Bhamakalpam. See here, next point. Dancing on the brass plate by keeping the feet on its edges is a feature of Bharatanatyam, but Kuchipudi dance does not have such a form of movement. It's a wrong statement, not right statement. Why? Because the dancing on the brass plate with the feet is a fundamental attribute of Kuchipudi dance. Try to remember, because in Kuchipudi different varieties, different variants we can come across for your kind information. For example, Thala Chitra Nrutya. Always try to understand. Thala Chitra Nrutya. Thala Chitra Nrutya means whenever a dancer who is dancing, whenever a dancer who is performing a dance at the time, by using his toes, he is to draw the drawings or he is to draw the diagrams by using his toe. That mode of Kuchipudi, popularly called as Thala Chitra Nrutya. Dancer is drawing, try to remember, dancer is to draw the diagrams on the floor, with his toe. Try to remember. And one more, dancing on the brass plate, that mode is known as what? Dancing on brass plate, edges of brass plate. Anybody? Gopala Taranga. Gopala Taranga. It's called as Gopala Taranga. And the third important aspect, Matka. The Matka element, it is exclusively associated with Kuchipudi dance form. It's an important element of Kuchipudi. Always right. Matka means pot. Where they used to keep the pot on their head at the time of dancing. Try to remember. That's what we will call as matka. Okay. Thereby, dancing on the brass plate by keeping the feet on its edges is a fundamental feature of not Bharatanatyam. It's a fundamental feature of Kuchipudi. Okay. Try to remember. And then one more concept is there. Manduka Shabdam. Manduka Shabdam. Always try to remember. Manduka Shabdam. Okay. Manduka means what? Frog. Try to remember. Manduk. Then what about correct statements here? One only correct. Okay. Here one only correct. One more important. With reference to the famous Satriya dance, consider the following statements. What about the importance of Satriya dance when compared to other classical dances? See, when compared to other classical dances, the Satriya it mainly emerged as 8th classical dance of Indian culture. Okay, 8th classical dance, because they accorded the classical dance status by Sangeet Natak Academy in 2000. Okay, try to remember Sangeet Natak Academy in 2000. But whenever you, what was the exact meaning of the term Satriya? Satriya. What was the exact meaning of the concept Satriya? Satriya means monastery. Always try to remember monastery, or we can also consider it as hermitage. Monastery or hermitage. That today in colloquial parlance, in common parlance, we refer Satriya as a chatra in Kannada. Chatra barutala, Kannadalli chatragalu antivalla, adu Satriya. In English, monastery or hermitage. Right, remember, where this transform, it developed in monastery or hermitage by a 15th century great saint, great saint, scholar, as well as social reformer, Mahapurush Shankar Dev. Okay, right, remember, 15th century AD. Even timeline is also important. Sometimes they used to ask the questions based on timeline also. If you go through the Satriya dance, where the Satriya, it was first incorporated, it was first popularized by the great saint, great scholar, as well as the social reformer, the Mahapurush Shankar Dev, pertaining to the state of Assam. Please try to remember, which was an important ruling dynasty at that time, means an important ruling dynasty at that time, Ham dynasty. Okay, try to remember, it was a ruling realm belonged to Assam. Try to go through it. He popularized. Why? He composed a unique kind of song or songs in order to propagate Vaishnavism in Assam. Correct? That unique kind of music or a song is known as what? They can ask this time. Definitely, no doubt in that. We don't know, Nopa. They may ask anything. Whatever they want, they can ask. Bor Geet. Correct? Bor Geet. Bor Geet. No doubt in that. Try to go through it in order to popularize Vaishnavism. And he also popularized one important art form. Which was that art form? Shankar Deva also popularized an important art form. Right, remember, where that art form, it was popularly called as Bhavana. Bhavana art form. Where he popularized an important art form known as Bhavana art form. So far you have come across? Yes or no? Bhavana art form. Bhavana art form. That's very, very important. Try to go through it. Then, first statement. Look at first statement. Satriya is a combination of music, dance, and drama. See, sometimes they will ask. Sometimes they used to ask whether it's a combination of music, dance, or drama. Especially in statements only they used to ask. No doubt in that. Statements only. Thereby, if you go through the Satriya dance, it is a combination of music, dance, and drama. All three in combination, where it constitutes the perfect blend of all the three important aspects, music, dance, as well as drama. Clear now? Try to understand. Then statement number one must be correct. Then which choice where we can go for elimination? See, we can go for elimination because we cannot come across the statement number one here. Okay. Then it is a centuries old living tradition of Vaishnavites of Assam, definitely. Yeah, even today it's a living legacy of Assam. Thereby statement number two is also correct. Right, remember. Then where we can come across both one and two in B. Correct, right, remember. And D is also there. One, two and three is there. Thereby we have to consider B and D as our choices. Next, three, it is based on classical ragas and talas of devotional songs composed by Tulsidas, Kabir and Mirabai. Huh? Right or wrong? Huh? Definitely. Yeah. Then, it's a right statement. Huh? It's a right statement. Yeah, that's what. Okay, Tulsidas, Kabir and then Mirabai. Influenced. Thereby, answer must be 1, 2 and 3 are correct. Right or wrong? Both, all the three are correct. No doubt in that. All the three are correct. See here, sometimes we used to think we will go for elimination, then we will opt for 1 and 2 only. Correct? I remember. Then there is the matter. Next. With reference to Buddhist history, tradition and culture in India, consider the following phase. Consider the following phase. See here, what about the history here? Buddhist history. Famous saying, Thabo Monastery and Temple Complex, Spiti Valley. Right? Yeah, we can come across. Lhotsawa Lakhong Temple Nako. No. See here, so simple here. Whenever you will go through the Jaskar Valley, the Jaskar Valley, it's belong to, correct? And remember, yeah. Jaskar Valley, Jaskar Valley. Then first one is correct.
Yes.
Which one of the face given above is are correctly matched? First one is definitely correct, no doubt in that. Is it Lhotsawa Lakhong Temple in Nako? Is it right or wrong? Wrong. Okay. And Alchi Temple Complex, Ladakh. Why Ladakh? Alchi Temple Complex. Where this Ladakh, it is always considered as a cradle of Buddhist culture. It's a cradle of Buddhist culture. That's all. There is the matter. It's a cradle of Buddhist culture. Thereby it must be one and three, not one, two and three. These are all simple. You need not to be worried about it. Then the next important one. With reference to the history of Indian rock cut architecture, consider the following statements. See, whenever you will go through rock cut architecture, the first and foremost point, who introduced the nuances of the cave architecture in India, or rock cut architecture in India? Who was the first ruler who introduced rock cut architecture in cultural history of India? Anybody? Who was the first person who introduced the rock architecture? A rock cut architecture. The rock cut architecture, it was first introduced by Emperor Ashoka. Barabara Cues. Right? And his grandson Dasaratha. Emperor Ashoka and his grandson Dasaratha, isn't it? Look at the statements. The caves at Badami are the oldest surviving rock cut caves in India. No way. No way. I remember Badami caves. Why we can reject the first statement means the Badami caves constituted for the first time by a Western Chalukya ruler Mangalesha. Okay, Western Chalukya ruler Mangalesha. Right, remember during 6th century AD. Okay, then the Barbara rock cut caves were originally made for Ajivikas by Emperor Chandragupta Maurya. Means for the first time. Right, understand this. Ajivikas. Maha Kala Gosala was an important ascetic who associated, ascetic associated with Ajivika means Mahakala Gosala Putta. Okay? Barbara Rakat gives. See, why they've incorporated Ajivikas means after the construction of this Barbara Caves, where the Barbara Caves basically donated to Ajivika sect. I remember, even by Ashoka and his grandson Dasaratha. Correct, I remember. Why? Because the Emperor Ashoka's father Bindusara, he patronized Ajivika sect, where he converted to Ajivika sect with the influence of the great soothsayer who adorned the court of Bindusara, Pingalavastu. Are you getting my point? Pingalavastu. Thereby, where during the rule of Mauryans, the Barbara Rockart caves especially donated to Ajivika sect. Okay, where they patronized Ajivika sect. It must be a right statement. Try to understand this. It must be a right statement. Where we can come across two here, we can eliminate A. And then we can also eliminate C. Correct? A and C we can easily eliminate. Then we must look for third statement. At Ellora, caves were made for different beds. Definitely. Whenever we will go through Ellora, no, the Ellora, it always represents composite culture. If any student who always consolidate the theme of composite culture, means there is no secondary thought while opting for third statement, thereby the answer must be 1 to 3. Correct? Try to remember. Whenever Ellora caves, it is a best example for composite culture or syncretic culture, means then there is no need of looking for any other statements. Directly we can go for the answer or the right choices or the appropriate choices. Is it clear, room? The Nagara, the Dravida, and the Vesara are such a simple question, but direct question, direct shoot. Okay, three main racial groups of the Indian subcontinent, no? Three main linguistic divisions into which the languages of India can be classified. This is what the beauty of a UPSC here. See how they will formulate these statements to create flutter in the minds of aspirants. Don't fall prey. Okay, then three main styles of Indian temple architecture. Any Tom, Dick, Harry can say this. Correct? Try to remember. Not only by a respective faculty. Three, how? Now I want to pose a question. On what basis, on what fundamental parameter were they classified three important styles of temple architecture in Indian culture? On what basis? What parameter they followed? What parameter, fundamental parameter they followed in order to classify three important classical styles in temple architecture? On the basis of superstructure built over sanctum or sanctorium. On the basis of superstructure, it built over sanctorium, where they classified the temple architecture into three important styles. Please try to remember. Suppose if you go through Dravida style, correct? Try to remember. In Dravida style, where we can come across a pyramidal structure which was built over sanctum and sanctum or sanctorium at the finial end. What kind of end? At the finial end. Try to remember. Where we can come across a monolithic structure called as stupika, where this stupika was embedded with the kalasha, or this kalasha also known as vase. Correct? Try to remember. Are you getting my point? Based on this superstructure, suppose if you go through North Indian temples, in North Indian temples, where this fluted disc, horizontal fluted disc we can come across, correct? This is a fundamental difference between the South Indian temple and North Indian temple. The horizontal fluted disc. Where that horizontal fluted disc, it was popularly called as Amulaka. Where this Amulaka also considered as the crowning element. Okay, crowning element. And remember, thereby, where this entire structure, what we will call it as cruciform structure. Cruciform structure. And one more concept is there. how you can distinguish between the different styles of temple architecture means not only on the basis of the stupa structure it was built over sanctum sanctorium. At the same time, if you go through, please try to remember here what we will call. Here we will call it as vimana, correct? The tiers, the successive tiers, the successive stories. For example, Brihadeshwara temple, it consists of 13 stories, correct? Try to understand this. The subsequent or successive stories. If you go through these marked lines, popularly called as the concept, what we will call pagoda. Correct? Can we come across the same pagoda concept in South Indian temples? Not at all. Right? Remember, not at all. See, this is one more distinctivity we can come across. And I can also this arrangement in a temple architecture known as what? Art and culture, no? Use a lot of thrill to explain. We can enjoy it to the core here. Enjoy it to the core. Such a wonderful area here. Such a wonderful area. Hey, let them ask whatever question they want to ask here. Let them ask. Come on. This kind of arrangement known as what? See, this is a main shrine. Okay, main shrine. Where this main shrine surrounded by subsidiary shrines. This is what we will call cluster complex. Cluster complex. C and C. Correct? Yeah, it must be correct only here. Cluster complex. This tail is known as what? Come on. Good. Panchayatna style. Correct, I remember. For example, I will give one more important example. Dvikuta. What was meaning of Dvikuta? Dvikuta, Trikuta, correct? Chaturkuta, isn't it? Where we can come across? In which style of architecture we can come across this Dvikuta, Trikuta, Chaturkuta? Vaisala style of architecture. In South India, that's all part. Try to understand basics here. You will never miss a single question. No doubt in that. Okay. And in South India, the temple architecture is based on Agama Shastras. Whereas in North India, it is based on Chitra Sutra. Okay. Try to understand this. Here, then three main styles of Indian temple architect. Try to go through the characteristic feature. If you go through any temple architecture, at that time you must remember important characteristic features. Okay, important characteristic features. Where on what basis they are formulating questions attributed to different styles of temple architecture means they will always emphasize some important characteristic features. And then the royal realms, which are all the important royal realms, patronized a respective style of temple architecture. And then they will also ask the questions with regard to indigenous styles of temple architecture. Okay, indigenous styles of temple architecture. That's very, very important. And the important regions. And then the religion. Which religion? Where that particular temple architecture associated with. Correct? These are the core concepts where you must always remember. Clear? Important characteristic features. Whenever you will go through important characteristic features, no, try to go for key concepts. They're in the matter. Is it clear? No? Three main linguistic divisions, no? Three main styles of Indian temple, three main musical gharanas prevalent in India. Where gharanas here? What is are common to the two historical places known as Ajanta and Mahabalipuram? Ajanta and Mahabalipuram. Both are cultural centers. Correct? Both are cultural centers. but they have got their own distinctive features. Try to remember, both the places has got their own distinctive features. Both were built in the same period. How come here? First statement itself, where we can immediately eliminate whenever we will go through, both were built in the same period, because where this Ajanta always considered as a living panorama of Indian architecture. Always try to remember which place in Indian cultural history considers a living panorama of Indian architecture. Means Ajanta always considers living panorama of Indian architecture or Indian culture. Not only that, Ajanta, it always considered as Athens of Asia. Okay, Athens of Asia, and it was included in UNESCO World Heritage List. Correct? Try to remember. And especially where this Ajanta, it always yields the evidence for the Buddhist architecture. Correct? I remember several times they asked a question in UPSC, especially pertaining to the first cave of Ajanta. Why first cave of Ajanta? It yields the evidence for Bodhisattvas, especially among Bodhisattvas, which Bodhisattva? Padmapani, Manjushri, Amitabha, Gautama, Maitreya. Maitreya was popularly called as future Buddha. He was equivalent to the 10th avatar of Vishnu known as Kalki. Correct? Then, both belong to the same religious denomination. How come? Correct? Try to understand. How come? Then, the third one. Both have rock cut monuments. Definitely. Both are having familiarity with rock cut monuments. Why rock cut monuments? Suppose if you take Mahabalipuram, what was the unique attribute of Mahabalipuram? What about historical significance or cultural significance of Mahabalipuram? The Mahabalipuram was popularly called as a birthplace of Dravidian style of temple architecture. Who was a brainchild behind this temple architecture where it emerged at Mahabalipuram? Means Narasimha Varma I. Correct? I remember. Narasimha Varma I. That's why he adorned the title Mahabali. When we emphasize on Mahabalipuram, recently it was in news because the informal summit was held between India and China. Correct? I remember. Try to go through it. Even it is also having familiarity with the Open Art Gallery, the Arjuna Finance. Try to remember. Open Art Gallery, Mahabalipuram. Thereby, the Mahabalipuram, it always yields the evidence of the freestanding rock cut temples. Freestanding rock cut temples of India. Are you getting my point? Freestanding. This is very, very important. The Ajanta not only belong to a particular royal realm, where several royal realms, they contributed for the flourishment of art at Ajanta. Here now. Everything is only with reference to the Indian history of art and culture, consider the following phase. So easy. See, a grand image of Buddha's Mahaparinirvana. That's why I told only keywords. Even in writing your main answers also. Keywords. Correct? No? Yeah, Mahaparinirvana. Which cave we can come across Mahaparinirvana? We already discussed in the class in detail. Isn't it? Oh, pakka, no doubt in that. How come where I can compromise in my content here? Mahaparinirvana, 29th cave of Ajanta. Okay, 29th cave of Ajanta. The symbolic representation of death of Buddha. Numerous celestial musicians above and the sorrowful figures of his followers below. Definitely it must be Ajanta, correct? I remember, because Ajanta, some are Vihara, some are Chaityas. Then A is correct, no doubt in that. Correct, A is correct. Which we can eliminate here? B we can eliminate immediately. Okay, a huge image of Varaha avatar, Boar incarnation. See, as soon as you will come across Boar incarnation, where in your mind it must linger Udaygiri caves. Please try to remember Udaygiri caves. Whenever you will go through this Udaygiri caves, at Udaygiri caves, the incarnation of Vishnu in the form of boar. Right, remember, in the form of boar. during Gupta period, Udaygiri, okay, Vishnu. Then, see which place they have given here. If you go through Udaygiri means, automatically with the logic you can opt for the right choice. Mount Abu. Mount Abu is famous for what? Mount Abu famous for Dilwara temples. Where this Dilwara temples built in Indo-Islamic style. Architecture only. Okay. Indo-Islamic style. Huh? Mount Abu. Next, third one. Arjuna penance. In prior question where we discussed Mamallapuram, correct, I remember. Then the 1 and 3 are correct. Correct? 1 and 3 are correct. With reference to the art and archaeological history of India, which among the following was made earliest? Which one of the following was made earliest? Earliest. Lingaraja temple at Bhuvaneshwar. When you go through this Lingaraja temple at Bhuvaneshwar, it always constitutes a concept in Indian architecture called as golden triangle. Always try to remember. They may ask, which three important monuments of Indian cultural history constitutes golden triangle? Means, the Lingaraja temple at Bhuvaneshwar, it constitutes golden triangle. Which are the other two? Which are the other two? Jagannatha temple Puri and Konark Sun temple. All these three constitutes golden triangle. Golden triangle. Lingaraja temple at Bhuvaneshwar. See, when we go through this temples at Orissa, always try to remember Gangas. Gangas. Simply, we cannot go through superficial way. By in superficial way, we cannot discuss by any concepts. Gangas. If you go through Gangas, there are two important branches. Western Gangas and Eastern Gangas. Always try to remember from your examination perspective. The Western Gangas, they made an outstanding contribution or substantial contribution in flourishment of Jaina culture. Okay, Jaina culture, Western Gangas, especially in Western Gangas or among the Western Ganga rulers, Rachamalla IV, because his court was adorned by Chaundaraya, a court commander of Rachamalla IV, where he made substantial contribution. Example, Bahubali, yeah, the monolithic statue, please try to remember. Then Eastern Gangas, they made an outstanding contribution to Hinduism. Or Hindu culture, flourishment of Hindu culture. There is a fundamental difference between these two branches, the Western Gangas and Eastern Gangas. If you go through, once they asked in your UPSC exams, which region ruled by Eastern Gangas? Which region was ruled by Eastern Gangas? Eastern Gangas ruled Kalinga region. Eastern Gangas ruled Kalinga region. I get my point. Kalinga region. Don't forget. Lingaraja temple at Bhuvaneshwar, it constitutes an important constituent of golden triangle. And rock cut elephant at Dhauli. Perfect answer. Why rock cut elephant means? Where this rock cut elephant, it always signifies Buddhist culture. Right, Jordan? It always signifies Buddhist culture. The rock cut elephant at Dhauli, it always signifies Buddhist culture, Dhauli. And rock cut monuments at, please try to remember, rock cut monuments at Mahabalipuram. No, later stages we can come across. We have already studied Varaha image at Udaygiri. Okay, then answer must be B. Try to remember, Tosali, also known as Tosali. Why Dhauli is so important? Dhauli means where we can come across a war ravaged region. War ravaged region. Which war was responsible for? Kalinga War. Where that Kalinga War? It was fought in 261 BC. That in turn responsible for victory of Ashoka. Correct? And remember, not only victory of Ashoka, for your kind information, it was fought on the river bank, Daya. Okay? Try to remember. Daya. Rocket monuments at Mahabalipuram, Morhai Major, Udaygiri. Then choice answer must be B. Next. Where is the famous questions must not be asked here. Where is the famous Vichayavitthala temple having its 56 chord fillers emitting musical notes located? Where is the famous Vichayavitthala temple? Then what about the Belur? Belur is famous for Vaisala architecture. Okay, try to remember. What about Bhadrachalam, Andhra Pradesh? Bhadrachalam, try to go through it. And Srirangam, Tamil Nadu. Okay, where this place has got so much of significance for Vaishnavism. Okay, try to understand. Hampi. Hampi. Where is the matter? Where is the famous Virupaksha temple located? You must not ask this type of question. Yeah, for really. Chidambaram, I think all of you know. Sri Kalasthi also. Bhadrachalam, Chidambaram, Sri Kalasthi. Chidambaram, no? Where this Chidambaram, it was famous for Nataraj images. King of dance. Okay, try to remember. Sri Kalasthi. Sri Kalasthi is famous for Vijayanagara style of temple architecture. We will come across. Next we will see. Next question. Building Kalyana Mantapas was a notable feature in the temple construction in the kingdom of Vijayanagara. Correct? Yeah. Any Tom the Kari can answer. Correct, Nupa? Which are the other two important features of Vijayanagara style of temple architecture? Which are the other two important characteristic feature of Vijayanagara style of temple architecture? Vijayanagara style of temple architecture. Come on. Vijayanagara style of temple architecture. Anybody? Raya Gopurams. It always marks the social supremacy of Vijayanagara rulers, Raya Gopurams. Okay, try to remember Raya Gopurams. And construction of Amma Shrines. Construction of Amma Shrines. These are other two important characteristic features of Vijayanagara style of temple architecture. Okay, try to remember construction of Amma Shrines. Where these Amma Shrines are considered as cultural abodes of Vijayanagara Empire. Try to remember, cultural abodes of Vijayanagara Empire. Raya Gopuram. Clear? Then here you must mark answer D. Vijayanagara Kalyana Mandapa. For Raya Gopuram, the best example, Vijaya Vittala Swami Temple, Hampi, and Kalahasti. These are the two best examples of Vijayanagara Raya Gopurams. Which one of the following statements is not correct? It's very easy. The statue of Gommateshwara at Shravanabelagola represents the last Tirthankara of Jains. He was not a Tirthankara. He didn't attain Tirthankara status. Correct? He didn't attain Tirthankara status. And remember, India's largest Buddhist monastery is in Arunachal Pradesh. Kujarabo temples were built under Chandela kings. Definitely, It was built under Chandela kings from when to when? From when to when? Chandela kings. If you go through the Chandela kings, the Nagara style of temple architecture reached its zenith. Reached its zenith or pinnacle of glory during the rule of Chandelas. Correct? I remember Chandelas. Pujarao temples, the best example, isn't it? Chandela king Danga. He was a great contributor to architecture from 950 AD to almost 1050 AD. Okay? 950 AD to 1050 AD. Is it clear? Then what about answer? B. Okay. A. It's a wrong. A is correct answer. Not correct, no? That's what. Okay. Next we will move on to. Indian Airlines or have redesigned their logo, which is a graphic wheel. This logo has been inspired from which one of the following? Sun Temple of Konark, Hampi Temple, Mamallapuram Temple, Sun Temple of Konark. What about speciality of the Sun Temple of Konark? Sun Temple of Konark. What is the speciality? Here it was popularly called as Black Pagoda. The European sailors, they called Sun Temple as Black Pagoda. Correct? I remember. Where they have constituted the Sun Temple as a navigational point. Correct? I remember. Navigational point. Navigational point. In Mugita Idiri. Okay, today I am ending this session. Tomorrow we will continue.
You can continue, Martha.
Yesterday we completed up to the architecture of ancient as well as medieval period. Today it's a continuation. In today's continuation, the first question, the Indian Airlines have redesigned their logo, which is a graphic wheel. This logo has been inspired from which one of the following? Okay. The answer must be Sun Temple of Konark in Indian Airlines, where we can come across. Where they have constituted this temple in the form of a chariot. They have sculpted wonderfully, so beautifully. Correct? Right? Remember, almost 24 wheels. Drawn by how many horses? 7 horses. Correct, I remember the chariot. Khajuraho temple. Where this Khajuraho, no? It is called as City of Gods. Always try to remember. Which cultural place in India is called as City of Gods, means Khajuraho. Okay. Who called or who considered Khajuraho as a City of Gods? Because Khajuraho temple is recently in news. Why recently in news? Khajuraho festival. Correct, I remember. Khajuraho festival. Khajuraho festival. Khajuraho temple, not only the festival, even where there was an irregularities in maintenance of Khajuraho temples. This is very, very important. There was irregularities in maintenance or in preservation of Khajuraho temples. Please write them. That's why it was recently in news. Who called or who considered Khajuraho temple as a city of gods, means Al-Biruni. This is important. That's why. See, the traveler statements are important always in history, correct? The traveler statements are important always. Khajuraho temple, cultural cradle of Chandelas. Okay? Cultural cradle of Chandelas. Is it clear? Then, next we will move on to which one of the following is our famous for Sun Temple? I remember Amarkanta, Omkareshwar. If you go through Sun Temple, in different regions we can come across Sun Temples. Sun Temples. But in South, which was a famous Sun Temple, means Surya Narayan Temple of Arasavalli. Arasavalli. It is in Srikakulam district. It is in Srikakulam district. Are you getting my point? It is in Srikakulam district. And then Marthanda. It is also Sun Temple, belong to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Modera, it is also where we can come across Sun Temple, belong to Gujarat. Okay, Modera Sun Temple we can come across. Thereby, if you go through, please try to remember, the choice must be one only, a only, Amarkantak. No, Amarkantak. What is the geographical significance of Amarkantak? Where this Amarkantak always considered as heritage point. What kind of point it is? Heritage point. Because it's a meeting place of Vindhyas and Satputras. Vindhyas and Satputras. Are you getting my point? Meeting place, Amarkantak. We have already discussed, right? No? Then further there is no question of discussion. We will skip this question. Okay? More important question here. With reference to the cultural history of India, consider the following statements. Look at the statements. Try to apply your logic. White marble was used in making Buland Darwaza and Kanka at Fatehpur Sikri. Yeah, Buland Darwaza built by Akbar, correct? It's a lofty gateway, the biggest gateway in the world, correct? I remember. Okay, and then Kanka. What was the meaning of Kanka? What was the meaning of Kanka? You hailed from which district of Karnataka? Belagama. Okay. Bijapur means then I used to grill them like anything. Bijapur or Gulbarga, especially not. You are from which state, which district? Raichur. Yeah, Raichur also. Come on, Kanka. Whenever we will go through, Kanka means always try to remember Kanka, an institution of Sufism. Always try to remember. An institution of Sufism. Kanka is an institution of Sufism. Where an institution of Sufism, it established a benevolent relationship between Pir and Murid. Pir means Sufi teacher. Murid means disciple. Okay? Where it established perfect relationship or benevolent relationship between Pir and Murid in order to propagate the Sufi message to the masses, where they constituted Kankas. Where this Kanka, it was also known as Aspis. The Kanka is also known as Aspis. The Kanka, it was also known as Hermitage. Clear? Try to understand. It's also known as Hermitage. Clear? Then, first statement must be correct, no doubt in that. And see here, whenever you will go through the architecture, no, try to remember, try to consolidate two things in your mind. Especially in Mughals, they used to ask questions. Why, the examiners, they will always accord, or the paper setters, either it may be UPSC or provincial services, or the state public service commissions, they will always accord so much of importance to Mughal architecture. What is the reason behind it in cultural history? See, without cultural significance, in order to ascertain the cultural awareness among student fraternity or in student fraternity, where they used to formulate the questions. Come on, why? What is the reason? What is the reason means, always try to remember, in cultural history of India, there are two important ruling realms considered as classical ages. In cultural history of ancient period or during ancient period, the Gupta period or the Gupta age, it always constitutes the first classical age of India. Correct? Right? Remember, first classical age, which was the second classical age in the realm of cultural history of India, means Mughals. This is what important. they made an outstanding contribution in the arena of art and architecture, thereby where they used to ask the questions. Clear now? Then statement number is correct. First one is correct. Then we can easily eliminate 2 year. Correct? I remember 2 year. And year one is there. Definitely we have to consider. We will see. Then red sandstone and marble were used in making Bara Imamra and Rumi Darwaza at Lucknow. Bara Imamra. It mainly belonged to the rule of Nawabs of Lucknow. Nawabs of Lucknow, where this Bara Imamra, it was popularly called as Asafi. What they will call? It was popularly called as Asafi. It was popularly called as Asafi because it was built by Asafuddaula in 1784. Asafuddaula, Bara Imamra. Where this Bara Imamra, is it they have used red sandstone and marble? No. Because at that time, where it was plagued by famines, in order to rehabilitate, or in order to provide rehabilitative measures to his people, please try to remember where he started an important program called as Food for Work program. He was the first ruler who started this program. Always try to remember. He was the first ruler who started Food for Work program. Because at that time, in order to provide rehabilitation to the poverty-stricken people, okay, I remember, there is started a program. These two are always considered as economical monuments. I remember, economical monuments. The name itself signifies economical monuments. Why economical monuments? Instead of constituting these two important monuments by using red sandstone and marble, they used, please try to remember, lime and then brick. Lime and brick. Try to remember, they used lime and brick. Lime and brick. What about the meaning of Rumi? Rumi. What was the meaning of Rumi? Always try to remember, Rumi, it refers Roman. Okay, Rumi, it refers Roman. Darwaza, where this Rumi Darwaza, it was popularly called as Turkish Gateway because it was designed on the basis of Istanbul Gate. Okay, it was popularly called as Turkish Gateway. Try to go through it. But try to remember what mode of questions they are asking in your UPSC means, if you go through Mughal dynasty, there are two important phases of Mughal architecture. The first phase is known as red sandstone phase. The second phase is known as white marble phase. Always try to understand this. The red marble phase, it mainly belonged to the rule of Humayun as well as the Akbar. Only at fag end we can come across the usage of white marble. That too in Buland Darwaza. But who extensively used white marble to constitute the best specimens of Mughal architecture or the Mughal marvels means Shahjahan, especially the Taj Mahal. Correct, I remember. The best Mughal marvel. Is it clear? Then answer must be one only. Consider the following. The arrival of Babur into India led to the... Even I have already explained in class while dealing with Babur. What you must understand while preparing for civil services means, significance of advent of Mughals. Significance of advent of Mughals. Therein is the matter. Okay. Look at first statement. Try to apply your logic. Introduction of gunpowder in this subcontinent. No way. Correct. I remember. Yeah. If you consider the Delhi Sultanate rulers, who was the first Delhi Sultanate ruler who introduced gunpowder means Iltutmish. Iltutmish was the first person who used gunpowder, East Hyderabad. But the gunpowder, where it owes its origin to China. Okay, always try to remember. But subcontinent means in subcontinent Mongols. Subcontinent Mongols. Please try to remember. Then the first statement is wrong statement. Then you can go for elimination. Correct, try to remember. In all the three, one first statement is there, A, C, and D. Here we cannot come across. Try to understand this. Introduction of arch and doom in the regions of architecture. Introduction of arch and doom in the regions of architecture. No, try to remember, because the UPSC aspirants, they must understand the evolution of arch and doom architecture always. Arch and doom architecture. Because when he was exclusively engaged in wars, he didn't find an adequate time to constitute his own style of architectural elements. And remember, he didn't find, due to paucity of time. Then the third statement, establishment of Timurid dynasty in the region. Definitely Timurid, because where this Mughal dynasty, it always owes origin to Timur. Correct, try to remember. It always owes its origin to Timur. The destructor, try to remember, rogue. Then answer must be three only, clear? Philosophical schools of India, really one of the important area of your preparation, philosophical schools of India, philosophical schools. Whenever you will go through these philosophical schools, you must always remember Darshanic philosophy, correct? Darshanic, or you must remember Shadarshanas. Today I discussed a regular batch, Shadarshanas. Correct, six important philosophical schools. Now Ravi, be ready to answer. Okay, philosophical schools of India, because in world context, the Indian philosophy, it constitutes an important realm of world philosophy. Okay, right, remember, even the Westerners know, they have shown greater affinity towards Indian philosophy. The best example I can give you at this juncture, Max Müller. Right, remember, he was not only a great scholar, he was Vedantist. And among Mughal personalities, Dara Shikoh. He was not only a geographer, at the same time, he was also a Vedantist. What about contribution of Max Müller? The contribution of Max Müller in the arena of philosophy, Indian philosophy, where he translated Vedic corpus or Vedic scriptures from Sanskrit to English, where that collection was popularly called as Sacred Books of the East. Are you getting my point? Sacred Books of the East. And he was the first person who translated the fundamental nuances of Rig Veda into English. Are you getting my point? Try to understand. And then the Dara Shikoh, he was a personification of composite culture. Not only was a personification of composite culture, in order to ameliorate sectarian conflicts which existed between Hindus and Muslims. Thereby, he set the fundamental forum in order to constitute composite culture by incorporating an important scripture called as Mazmu'l-Bahrain. Where that Mazmu'l-Bahrain, it mainly deals with the confluence of what? Islamic culture as well as Hindu culture. Try to understand, Islamic culture as well as Hindu culture. These are the two best examples. But Westerners, they accorded a lot of importance for Indian philosophy. Which one of the following phase does not form part of the six systems of Indian philosophy? Six systems of Indian philosophy. Mimamsa and Vedanta, integral part of दार्शनिक स्कूल्स, न्याय एंड वैशेषिकल, करेक्ट, एंड लोकायत. व्हाट वाज द मीनिंग ऑफ लोकायत? कम ऑन, योर सेल्फ. कम ऑन, लोकायत मींस येनु. लोकायत अंदर द नेम इटसेल्फ सिग्निफाइज लोकायत, वेयर दिस लोकायत आल्सो नोन एज चार्वाक फिलॉसफी, करेक्ट. चार्वाक फिलॉसफी, इट वाज आल्सो नोन एज हेडोनिस्टिक फिलॉसफी. Hedonistic philosophy, also known as philosophy of people. This is important. Which philosophy? It was called as philosophy of people. Means lokaya. The name itself signifies lokayata. Not only philosophy of people, it is a philosophy of materialism. That's why hedonistic. Materialism. Materialism. Okay. लोकायत बाय हुम? हु वाज ए ग्रेट फिलोसोफर हु कंस्टिट्यूटेड लोकायत फिलोसफी और मटेरियलिस्टिक फिलोसफी, करेक्ट, आल्सो नोन एज मटेरियलिस्टिक फिलोसफी. कम ऑन, स्टडीड नो, स्टडीड नो. लेट देम आस्क व्हाटएवर दे वांट टू आस्क बिकॉज़ वी हैव ऑलरेडी डेल्ट. वी हैव डेल्ट and try to go through the content whatever we have given. Yeah, try to understand, then don't feel bad. Lokayata ajita ajita kesha kamlin ajita kesha kamlin katram ajita kesha kamlin. What mode of questions they are asking in your exams means proponents pertaining to particular philosophical school. Okay, right number, proponents. Next, philosophical precepts. Each school of philosophy, it has got its own principles. Okay, that's why philosophical precepts. Right, understand. And then the third important aspect, literary sources associated. See, these are three core areas of your preparation. Proponents they used to ask, even match the following they used to ask, which one of the pair is currently matched, which one of the following pair is not currently matched. Literary sources, right, remember, literary sources they used to ask, and current relevance. This is very, very important. Clear? No. Then what about Kapalika here? What was the meaning of Kapalika? Kapala means what? Skull. Thereby, Kapalika means skull bearer. Where they used to bear the skull. And remember, Kapalika. A non-Puranic Shaiva sect. Non-Puranic Shaiva sect. Not only it's a non-Puranic Shaiva sect, at the same time, an extreme form of Shaivism. Always try to remember, an extreme form of Shaivism. Clear? An extreme form of Shaivism. And what about the one more important characteristic features means, their body is always smeared with ash. Vibhuti irutala, vibhuti nella mai thumba achkondirtaru nodi, nodidira, have you seen? They are smeared with ash. And even in extreme form of Shaivism, we can also come across cannibalism. In extreme form of Shaivism, we can also come across cannibalism. What was the meaning of cannibalism, Simran? Come on, what is the significance or the meaning of cannibalism? Even which region geographically where we can come across the best example for cannibalism means Andaman Nicobar Islands. Correct, I remember. Andaman Nicobar Islands, where we can come across with regard to cannibalism in geography. करेक्ट, ईटिंग ऑफ देयर ओन स्पीशीज, करेक्ट, ईटिंग ऑफ देयर ओन स्पीशीज, सही सही सुन ली ना, देयर बाय लोकायता एंड कपालिका नॉट पार्ट ऑफ व्हाट सिक्स सिस्टम्स ऑफ इंडियन फिलोसफी. इज इट क्लियर? कपालिका, कपालिका, एंड आई विल ऑल्सो इनकॉर्पोरेट वन मोर इंपॉर्टेंट कॉन्सेप्ट, कालमुक्स. इज वन मोर कॉन्सेप्ट, कालमुक्स. ओके, कपालिकास और कालमुक्स. क्लियर? संख्या एंड योग, आई ऑलरेडी मेंशन द कोर एरियाज वेयर यू मस्ट एम्फसाइज. नेक्स्ट वी विल मूव ऑन टू वन मोर इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन विथ रेफरेंस टू द हिस्ट्री ऑफ फिलोसॉफिकल थॉट इन इंडिया. कंसिडर द फॉलोइंग स्टेटमेंट्स रिगार्डिंग संख्या स्कूल. Who was a great sage who propounded Sankhya school of philosophy? Kapila. Okay, the great sage Kapila, Kapila Muni. Kapila Muni, please remember. See, whenever you will go through Sankhya school, what the students they must imbibe, they must assimilate in their mind means it is a radical school of philosophy. Always try to remember. Which among six important philosophical schools, where the Sankhya school of philosophy must be considered as a radical, pragmatic school of philosophy, rational school of philosophy. Are you getting my point? Try to remember. Then, not only that, what was the exact meaning of the Sankhya? Thereby, where this is also considered as enumerist philosophy. Which one of the Indian philosophical school popularly called as enumerist philosophy means Sankhya. Always try to remember, it is an important enumerationist philosophy. Try to remember, enumerationist. Why enumeration means, suppose if you take census, is it not census must be considered as enumeration exercise? Correct? Try to remember, census it must be considered as enumeration exercise, not mere head count. Right, remember, it played a predominant role in formulation of a policy or policy framework to ensure socio-economic justice. Then, Sankhya does not accept the theory of rebirth or transmigration of soul. Right, remember, Sankhya does not accept the theory of rebirth or transmigration of soul. I already mentioned it's a radical school of philosophy. Correct, right, remember. Radical school of philosophy, when it's a radical school of philosophy, it also emphasized on the concept of self-knowledge. The self-knowledge is the key of human progress. Right, remember, self-knowledge is a key of human progress, not borrowed one. Self-knowledge, self-knowledge, please try to remember, it's always creative in its nature. It's always creative in nature or cognitive in nature. It is always cognitive in nature, not only creative in nature, it is a cognitive in nature. The cognitive capability, it always enthralls, it always expounds, it always prospers the nuances of self-knowledge. Right, remember, then Sankhya holds that it is the self-knowledge. See, just now without seeing the statement I am explaining, the Sankhya holds that it is the self-knowledge that leads to liberation and not any exterior influence agent. Correct? We will always consider atom is a basic entity of any element or compound, like a cell. Correct? The beautiful analogy. But according to Indian philosophy, the atoms are basically guided by supreme being, not by any force. Right, remember, not by any force, for your kind information. Try to go through the second statement. Sankhya holds that it is the self-knowledge that leads to liberation, not any exterior influence agent. Which one of the statements is given above is are correct? Both 1 and 2 are correct. Right, remember, both 1 and 2 are correct. Definitely, no doubt in that. Self-knowledge, try to underline it. This is important. It basically deals with human attributes, no doubt in that. Here, next we will move on to one more. According to Mimamsa system of philosophy, liberation is possible by means of according to, go through the question, according to Mimamsa system of philosophy, liberation is possible by means of Vaikarma, correct ma? You also attended, no? Come, Vaikarma, Vai? Oh, okay, what the actions has to be done. If you go through the Mimamsa, no? What was the exact meaning of Mimamsa, Simran? What was the exact meaning of Mimamsa? Ravi? What was the exact meaning of Mimamsa, ma? Yourself? The exact meaning of Mimamsa, enquiry. Correct. Yeah, it must be correct only. Okay? Mimamsa, enquiry. Try to understand. But the Mimamsa, it is always considered as Karma Mimamsa. There ends the matter here. It's always considered as Karma Mimamsa. What choice they have incorporated here? Karma. Thereby, the Mimamsa, it exclusively deals with study of actions. Study of actions. Right? Remember, the Mimamsa means a revered thought. That revered thought. Why revered thought? According to Mimamsa school of philosophy, the Vedas are the major sources of salvation. Correct? Right? Remember, Vedas are major sources of salvation because the Mimamsa school also considered as an orthodox school of philosophy. An orthodox school of philosophy, try to remember, whatever the actions, it always contributes to attain the stage of salvation. Try to remember, to attain stage of salvation, that's very, very important. Then here, jnana is there, bhakti is there. If you go through the jnana and bhakti, means at that time, you must always serve Vedanta. Okay, try to remember. They will ask one more important question. The Mimamsa associated with which two schools of philosophy? Which other two schools of philosophy? Mimamsa? Mimamsa? Come on. I will put a question mark. I will give time. You need not to worry about it. Vedanta. And then yoga. Who propounded yoga school of philosophy? Patanjali. Correct. I remember. How to ensure the perfect coordination or a pragmatic coordination between body and mind. And how to restrain from inconducive food factors. Consider the following statements. Bijak is a composition of the teachings of Saint Dadudai. Where? No way. Bijak is Kabir. Correct, right? Remember, Kabir. When we go through the Bijak concept, can you give one more important name for this? Okay, remember, Bijadva Sakhi. Then, statement one is wrong. Correct, I remember. Dadu Dayal promoted which movement? Dadu Dayal founded an important movement. Dadu Dayal founded an important movement known as Nipak movement. Nipak movement. Okay, try to remember. Nipak movement. The philosophy of Pushtimar was propounded by Madhvacharya. Not at all. Vallabhacharya, okay, path of grace. We already discussed. The philosophy of Pushtimarga was not propounded by Madhvacharya. It was propounded by Vallabhacharya. Okay, try to remember Pushtimarga, the path of grace. Prapatimarga? Who propounded Prapatimarga? Who propounded? See, the Pushtimarga propounded by Vallabhacharya. Then who propounded Prapatimarga? Prapati Marga means the self surrender to the God, complete surrender to the God. Prapati Marga propounded by the great saint of South India, Iliya Permal, popularly called as Ramanujacharya, Satyam Shivam Sundaram. New form of Vaishnavism propounded by Sri Ramanujacharya. Sri Ramanujacharya. Now they are constituting 216 feet of Ramanujacharya statue at Hyderabad. Correct? Try to remember. You might have studied in your current affairs. Then what about the right choice or an appropriate choice? Either one or two. Correct? No? Both the statements are irrelevant, wrong statements, thereby neither one nor two. Next, general questions. Which one of the following foreign travelers elaborately discussed about diamonds and diamond mines of India? Was John Baptist Tavernier? See, okay, I will ask one simple thing. What do you know about Francis Bernier? Who was Francis Bernier? Where this Francis Bernier? French doctor. He was a French doctor, doctor by profession, where he visited the courts of court of whom? Court of whom? Because here you must remember the foreign travelers. Try to understand patronage. They used to ask with regard to patronage. For example, if you take Sir Thomas Roe, where this Sir Thomas Roe adorned the patronage of Jahangir, correct? I remember where he came to India in order to seek the trade permit for the establishment of trade settlement, correct? I remember. Thereby, they used to emphasize on patronage. Apart from patronage, the detailed account, given by these foreign travelers. Whenever you will go through this detailed account, please try to remember, they used to ask, even in means also, for your kind information. Detailed account means it may pertain into art and architecture, it may related to economy, or it may related to society, or it may related to any religion. Okay, these are all the core areas where you must go through it. Okay, try to understand this. Put the concepts in different perspectives. Thereby, Francis Bernier, he was a French doctor. Even he wrote The Voyages to India, for your kind information. He visited during the rule of whom? Francis Bernier, Niccolo Munussi. I remember, Venetian traveler. Niccolo Munussi was a Venetian traveler where he emphasized on the war of succession between Dara Shikoh and Aurangzeb. Niccolo Munussi, I remember. Okay, Niccolo Munussi. Where he wrote an important travelogue, Stereo di Mogar, means the story of Mughals. Stereo di Mogar means story of Mughals. Try to understand. And not only detailed account, their travelogue. See, these are the three core areas. Here, and one more important personality, Peter Mundi visited India during the rule of Shah Jahan. Try to understand. Peter Mundi, Shah Jahan. Where the Peter Mundi, he especially emphasized on agrarian crisis during Shah Jahan's period. This is important. Yeah, agrarian crisis. Where according to some foreign travelers, the rule of Shah Jahan considers rule of beggars and barbarians. Okay, try to remember. Rule of beggars and barbarians. Instead of having flow in their hand, where they had weapons, right? Remember, weapons. Where it emphasizes on agrarian crisis or agrarian distress, where it loomed large during the rule of Shah Jahan. Jean Baptist Tavernier, but other two, we are not at all having any clarity or any relevance. Okay, Francis Bernier, Jean Baptist, try to go through William Hawkins, Sir Thomas Roe. Okay, try to remember Peter Mundi and Niccolo Munussi. Then what about the right answer? B. Okay. Jean Baptist Tavernier. Where this Jean Baptist Tavernier, he provided detailed account with regard to diamond mines. See, whenever we go through this diamond mines, no, always remember Golconda. Where at Golconda, it was popularly called as Vajrakarur. It was popularly called as Vajra Karur, okay? Because of diamond mines. Vajra Karur. Vajra Karur. Don't forget. One more important personality during Mughals, he was very much associated with the diamond trade, Mir Jumla. He mainly served as a governor general in the court of Aurangzeb, Mir Jumla. He also donated a Koinur diamond to Shah Jahan. Where that Koinur diamond? Try to understand. Mir Jumla. Mir Jumla. Even he ruled us parts of Assam. Assam, Mir Jumla. During the rule of? During the rule of whom? Aurangzeb. Prior to Aurangzeb, please try to remember, Mir Jumla, according to scholars, where he donated Koinur diamond. Koinur diamond to Shah Jahan. Shah Jahan, where it is popularly called as Takht-e-Taut. Takht-e-Taut. What was the meaning of Takht-e-Taut? The peacock throne of Shah Jahan. Peacock throne of Shah Jahan. Takht-e-Taut means peacock throne of Shah Jahan, where this Takht-e-Taut, it was designed by B. Badal Khan. It was designed by B. Badal Khan. It was studded with Koinur diamond. Later on, it was stolen by the Persian invader. Who was a Persian invader? Namshadu. Nadir Shah. Okay. Next. Who of the following had first deciphered the 100 times we discussed. Okay. Come on. James Prinsep. How we deciphered? That's what I want to test the general awareness of my respective students. How we deciphered? Pa? How we deciphered Ashokan documents? James Prinsep, an ICS officer, as well as he served as a secretary general of Asiatic Society of Bengal, founded by an Orientalist William Jones. Correct? I remember. He was also considered as father of Indology, along with one more personality, William Wilkins. The William Wilkins, the first person who translated Bhagavad Gita into English. William Jones, he also translated Abhijnana Shakuntala into English. Correct? I remember. James Prinsep, with the help of Buddhist chronicles. With the help of Buddhist chronicles. Clear? Yeah. Deepamsha, Mahamsha, Inamsha, everything we discussed, isn't it? And then Max Müller, yeah. Importance. William Jones, important. Then answer must be James Prinsep. Next we will move on to Banjaras. Banjaras during the medieval period of Indian history were generally traders. Simply, they have given traders here. Not simply they are traders. For your kind information, try to understand. They mainly emerged as mobile merchants during Alauddin Khilji period. During Alauddin Khilji period. Why? Because in order to replenish supply to what? Market system of Alauddin Khilji. To replenish the supply. Right? Remember? Here? Then answer must be D. Traders. Simply they have given traders. That's all. So easy, pa. With reference to forced labor. Visti in India during Gupta period. Which one of the following statements is correct? Come on, quick. It was considered as a source of income for the state. Okay. I want to give beautiful analogy for this. Pranaya. What does the meaning of pranaya? Don't think that it's romance. Yeah, pranaya means. Then? State emergency tax. Beautiful analogy. State emergency tax. where it was mentioned, Kautilya's Arthashastra. Kautilya's Arthashastra, Vishti. Suppose if they won't give Vishti, they may also incorporate Vetti. Even today we will call in Telugu Vetti Chakri. Okay? The forced labor was entitled to weekly wages. The eldest son of labor was sent to the forced labor. It was considered as a source of income of the state, a sort of tax paid by the people. Next, we will move on to with reference to the guilds, ancient India that played a very important role in the economy. Every guild was registered with the central authority of the state and the king was the chief administrative authority on them. In what way you can reject the first statement? Look at the first statement, go through the first statement. Simran, Ravi, how you will going to reject, how you will going to eliminate the first statement as soon as you will look at the first statement or you will go through the first statement, you will apply your logic. See, what statement they made here, what statement they incorporated. Every guild was registered with the central authority of the state and the king was the chief administrative authority. Where king was the chief administrative authority? Try to remember, there is one important thing. There are two important things I want to incorporate for a better understanding of my students. Okay? The first one, functional autonomy. What is there in history? The first concept, functional autonomy. Functional autonomy exercised by whom? Guilds. The functional autonomy, the functional niche exercised by the guilds. Okay, functional autonomy. The second important one, financial autonomy. The second important one, financial autonomy. See, these are the two important concepts. If you go through these two important concepts, outrightly you can reject the first statement. That's all. Clear? Try to understand. Functional autonomy and financial autonomy. Thereby, they have constituted their own setup. And one more important concept, Kusidin. Kusidin. What was the meaning of Kusidin? Not tax, yeah. How come tax? Dowry? No. Where dowry you can come across? For example, Ravi, when he become an officer, at that time, without taking dowry, where he will going to marry a girl? At that time, that form of marriage is called as Prajapatya. Prajapatya means without economic consideration, where a person is willing to marry a girl. Based on the chemistry, love. Kushi thing, money lending activity. Money lending activity. Really, it's to enjoy like anything here. Money lending activity. Money lending activity, try to remember. Isn't it? Money lending activity. Don't turn pages, pa. Where it has been mentioned? It has been mentioned in Shatapatha Brahmana, a later Vedic literature. It also deals with the nuances of socio-economic conditions which has been prevalent during later Vedic period. Correct? That in turn was also followed by the guilds because guilds basically served as bankers. Banking system. That's why I have incorporated financial autonomy. Correct? Yeah, it must be correct only here. No doubt in that. How come it will become wrong here? Then, then the wages, rules of work, standards and prices were fixed by the guild. The guild had judicial powers over its own members. What about the correct choices here? 2 and 3 are correct. the guild had, is it guild had judicial powers? Yeah, over its own members. Whenever any person who lend a money, see, during British legacy, we can come across an important law. I think how many of you know, I don't know. Popularly called as sunset law. Have you come across sunset law? In land tenure systems, Mahalwari, Raitwari, Jamindari, the permanent settlement of Bengal. You mean? Sir, class alli idini. Sunset law. Sunset law means if they fixed a time, a stipulated fine, within that stipulated time where they must remit the amount. Try to remember, or else whenever the peasants, they didn't remitted, where at the time where they must face the penalty or penalization. Correct? Try to remember. Yeah, that's what sunset. Okay, 2 and 3. Try to go through the guilds, pa. Just I will incorporate one important word, pa. Try to jot down puga. What was the meaning of puga? Try to go through it. Puga, P-U-G-A, puga. It's having pure relevance with the guild system. Even last class also, where I have already given an important example for this. Try to follow it. In the context of the history of India, consider the following case. Term description, Eripatti. Land revenue from which was set apart for the main tenants of the village. Yeah, correct? Eripatti, these are all Sangam age keywords. Okay, Tanyus. What was the meaning of Tanyus? Tanyus means the independent entities, exclusively exercised autonomy confined to villages, exclusively exercised the autonomy confined to villages. Okay, right, remember, independent entities. See here what they have given, villages donated to a single Brahmin or group of Brahmin. Whenever villages donated to a single Brahmin or group of Brahmin, means that in turn known as what? How you can reject it? How you can eliminate? Come on. Whenever they donated a single a village to a Brahmin or a group of Brahmins, means at that time you must remember it was popularly called as Devadeya. What you will call? Devadeya. Try to remember. Or it was also called as Brahmadeya. Devadeya, Brahmadeya. Or also known as Agrahara. See, these are the three important terminologies. Thereby you can outrightly reject it. Here, Devadeya, Brahmadeya or Agrara. Agrara means Brahminical settlement. Agrara is nothing but Brahminical settlement. The Shatavanas are the first rulers. They introduce the concept of land grants in South India. Guptas were the first rulers. They introduce land grants in Northern region. Boktas are Abhyantara Siddhi. And then, what a wonderful concept here. Ghatikas. The colleges generally attached to the temples. But what a statement you must made means with regard to Ghatikas. Ghatikas are the Brahminical learning centers of South. Always try to remember. Brahminical learning centers of South, popularly called as Ghatikas. Ghatikas. The best example, Kanchi. Kanchi. It was a famous Ghatika. Clear? Try to remember. Kanchi, it was a famous Ghatika. Then, 1 and 3 are correct. 1 and 3 are correct. See, UPSC people, they will always give the 1 and 3 choices here. Sometimes. But don't follow the same theme. Okay? You have to be aware of it. Because we have seen, we have studied, that's why. Okay? 1 and 3 are correct. Then yours. Next, we will move on to With reference to the economic history of medieval India, the term argata refers to, this has been asked in several competitive exams, try to remember. Yeah, argata means, see, always try to remember, whenever you will go through the term argata, irrigation, I read one important book, Agricultural System of Mughals, written by Irfan Habib. Such a wonderful book here. One must study. Agricultural System of Mughals, written by Irfan Habib. Irrigation, argata. What are the other terminologies or alternative terminologies where we can use? Suppose if they won't ask argata, in forthcoming UPSC examination in prelims, correct? I remember. What alternative themes are the concepts we can use to refer irrigation systems? See, for example, if they give the term kulya denotes, they will give four choices. What is the answer? The term kulya denotes. The term kulya denotes irrigation canal during ancient period. See? Is it not, it's having relevance? Definitely it's having relevance here. The term kulya, it denotes irrigation canal of ancient period. Are you getting my point? Kulya. Argata. See, whenever you will go through argata, rahat, one more alternative word, sakya, the second alternative word, okay, rahat, sakya, and then charas. Not that charas means whatever the drug concept, no, try to understand this. It's a congregation of leather buckets in order to draw the water from deep well. Okay, try to remember. Even Rehat Sakya, the lift irrigation where they used to use. See, these are other terminologies associated with the irrigation. Okay, thereby the water we used in irrigation of land, where it was popularly called as Persian wheel. What you will call? Persian wheel. Okay, try to remember. Popularly called as Persian wheel. Where that Persian wheel, it revolutionized the irrigation system. Revolutionized the irrigation system. With reference to the scientific progress of ancient India, which one of the statements given below are correct? Different kinds of specialized surgical instruments were in common use by 1st century AD. Definitely, no doubt in that. Different kinds of specialized surgical instruments were common use by 1st century AD. Definitely. Why? Why? Because who was the first surgeon of India? Sushruta. Okay, the first surgeon of India, Sushruta. Try to understand. Sushruta, where the Sushruta, he mainly belonged to a college of medicine, Kashi, the oldest living city in the world, okay, Kashi, try to remember, clear, then transplant of internal organs, no way, there itself we can eliminate, because the most advanced, correct, try to remember, the most advanced arena in medicine, transplantation of organs, please try to remember, xenotic, the what we will call the other organs donated towards life-saving mechanism. Then the concept of sine of an angle was known in 5th century AD. The mathematics is the only question mark for Mr. Gowda. Other than mathematics, where I can digest whichever subject I want. Okay. The concept of sine of an angle, it was popularly called as sine table. Where that sine table, it was first advocated by the great scholar, astronomer as well as mathematician Aryabhatta. Always try to remember, this is important. Who propounded the sine concept, means the sine table was propounded by the great scholar Aryabhatta. See, here they have given timeline, 5th century AD, try to remember, they have given timeline. And then concept of cyclical quadrilateral, where it was popularly called as orthodiagonal, cyclical quadrilateral, it was first given by Brahmagupta. was popularly called as Indian Newton. We have already discussed in the classroom. Try to go through. See, same question they asked. 7th century. Is it clear? Then what about the choices here? 1, 3, and 4. That's why I told 1 and 3 are so important. 1, 3, and 4 are so important. Okay. Blindly don't follow. Negative evaluation is there, no? That's all. That ends the matter. Apart from this, whatever the current aspects are there, try to go through the current aspects. Which city in the world has been recently declared by UNESCO as a city of the world architecture? In your current affairs, which city has been recently declared by UNESCO as a city of world architecture? Israel, how come? Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. Okay, try to remember. Any of all these concepts are available, try to go through it. And then the recent art forms in news, the recent art forms. Whenever you will go through these recent art forms, try to concentrate on Mithali paintings. And remember, that's very, very important. Or Madhubani paintings. Madhubani paintings. And then Sorai Kovai paintings. Sorai Kovai paintings. It was recently in news where it acquired GI tag. Please try to remember GI tag, where it is a traditional as well as ritualistic mural art form practiced by the tribal people. Try to remember. Practiced by the tribal people, especially Bihar, that is Hazaribagh. Okay, Hazaribagh. Even recently, an important airport at Jharkhand, Birsa Munda Airport. I remember Birsa Munda Airport, where it was painted with Sorai Kovai paintings. Okay, Sorai Kovai paintings. That's very, very important. Birsa Munda Airport. And not only that, the Hazaribagh railway station and Tata Nagar railway stations also depicted with Sorai Kovai paintings. See, like that, where one must go through it. Okay, that's all. There ends the matter. And then language and literature. And one more painting, it was recently in news, Tanjavur paintings. Recently, they expounded the gold in their paintings by using Raman spectroscopy. Try to go through it. Raman spectroscopy, that's very, very important. Tanjavur paintings. Okay. Tanjavur paintings. Try to concentrate on language and literature. In language and literature, this time they may ask with regard to Shilpadikaram. Okay, Shilpadikaram. Current concepts, try to go through it. Ends the matter. I wish a good luck for all the students who are giving their prelims. And God bless you all. From our institution side, we will always here to receive your ends, to empower your hidden talents, where we are putting our sincere efforts in order to provide fundamental impetus for our students to succeed in their attempts. Thank you all, where you have given me a wonderful opportunity to impart the insights with regard to art and culture, as well as with regard to ancient as well as medieval Indian history. Thank you all. God bless you.